Good morning, everyone. It's Pastor Jim Harkless once again from the Canyon Community Church in Lake Hay, California. It's December the 11th, 2022. This morning, we continue our series of 1 Corinthians, correcting spiritual immaturity in the local church. We look at the spiritual gifts in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, but also over in Romans chapter 12. We're considering the motivation gifts of exhortation and of giving. Glad you're with us. Let's have a song, and we'll join our message in progress. Just as a programming note, the next 2 weeks will be a Christmas theme messages as we celebrate Christmas coming up. We'll be, in January 1st, we'll be back to spiritual gifts instead of being Luke. I want to finish up the motivation gifts. January 8th, I'll be in the book of Ephesians for spiritual gifts. Then I'll be gone the 15th, the 22nd, and the 27th of January going to Israel. And Wally's going to be filling the pulpit. So pray for him. We bring him from the Psalms and encourage him. But this morning we'll be back in our study in 1 Corinthians. As we do, we want to open our Bibles to 1 Corinthians, and we continue our looking at the spiritual gifts this morning. The theme of 1 Corinthians has been correcting spiritual immaturity in the local church, and the whole occasion that Paul's talking about spiritual gifts in Corinthians is that we found he was addressing a problem that was occurring, one of many problems occurring in the Corinthian church, that from spiritual immaturity or carnality, which is the same. And a lot of things are going on in the Corinthian church. We've seen already in the earlier chapters of divisions within the church, sexual immorality, had questions about being single, being married, getting divorced, getting remarried, talking about the freedom we have in Christ. And then we're talking about, he's also addressing the issue of spiritual gifts and the abuse of the gifts which occurring in the church of Corinth. So, if you recall back in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 1, the King James Version says this. He says, "Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you be ignorant." And so we've been taking the time to talk about the spiritual gifts, looking at each one of them. We're going to look at all the 20-some gifts that are in the New Testament, that what they are and what their function, how they're meant to be used. And so we've been looking at 1 Corinthians 12, but also we've been actually in Romans chapter 12. We'll be there in Romans 12 again just shortly. But we've discovered so far by a quick review, and it's so important to do this series just because so many people lack knowledge or information, or they're misinformed about the spiritual gifts that God has given to the church and how they function. So we've been reviewing it, and we discovered that each Christian, believer, if you're a Christian in Jesus Christ, you have been given a spiritual gift by the Holy Spirit. In addition to being born again, have your sins forgiven. But God's given you a special gift, a special enabling by the Holy Spirit to be used to encourage others within the body of Christ. So every Christian has been given a spiritual gift. And we saw that in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. I'm not going to take time to read there, just for reference. Also in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10, talking about giving a special gift and way to employ it. The second thing we've learned, that the purpose of the gifts is for the common good. In other words, not for our own personal entertainment or our own personal edification, but for building up the body of Christ. We saw that in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7. Again, I'm reviewing some things. We discovered the Holy Spirit that gives the gifts as He wills. He's what dispenses the gifts. So you wouldn't say, "Well, I want to have this gift, I want to have that gift." It's the Holy Spirit doing it. 1 Corinthians 12, verse 11 says that as He wills. So you can't request a gift. He's going to give it to you. And it's not about what we want. It's like not going to Walmart or we went to the supermarket. I like this. I want this. I want that. It's what He gives us to work with. We also saw that all the gifts are to be used on the power and enabling and filling of the Holy Spirit. In other words, we live a Christ-led and Christ-guided or Spirit-guided life as we seek to be filled and used by the Holy Spirit. He will put those gifts to use in our life to be a blessing of others. The fifth thing we saw is from a word study of 1 Corinthians 12, verses 4 to 6, and let's look there, 1 Corinthians 12, 4 to 6, it's going to indicate there's three distinct groupings, or if you would, categories of spiritual gifts. I'm reading 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 4 to 6, and the scripture says, "Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of ministries, and the same Lord. And there are varieties of effects, but the same God who works all things in all persons." So there's three unique groupings of gifts. The charismas, or I like to call them the motivation gifts, and we'll look at them in Romans chapter 12 in just a minute. There's also a category of ministries or roles or functions, and then we'll look at that after this in Ephesians chapter 4. But there's a third grouping of gifts, that of effects, energemia. It means the manifestations or action results of those gifts that are going forth. So we looked at seven primary motivation gifts in Romans chapter 12. Let's look at Romans 12. We'll be there this morning. It'll be our main text we'll be looking at again. I'm going to be reading Romans chapters 12, verses 6 through 8. And then we focus in on two of the gifts, the gift of exhortation and the gift of giving this morning. I'm reading Romans chapter 12, verse 6. Says, "Since we have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, each of us is to exercise them accordingly. If prophecy, according to the proportion of his faith. If service, in his serving. Or he who teaches, in his teaching. Or he who exhorts, in his exhortation. He who gives with liberality or generosity. He who leads with diligence, and he who shows mercy with cheerfulness." So there's seven gifts mentioned: prophecy, service, teaching, exhortation, giving, leading or administration, and then finally the gift of mercy. And we saw before previously in the previous series, where they are recorded, by the way, you can catch them on YouTube or on Facebook, that the gift of prophecy is the motivation and the ability given by the Holy Spirit to a believer to help proclaim God's truth before others. We also looked at the gift of giving, the spiritual gift of giving, which is the motivation and the ability by the Holy Spirit for a believer to serve and meet the practical needs of others. We looked at a person with the gift of giving, they see a practical need, whether it's fixing a door, doorknob is broken, or a broken step, or to see a need, somebody needs some meals brought in, they just do it. They just pick up and do it, and they just make it happen, meeting practical needs. We looked at the gift of teaching also last time, the motivation to explain or expound God's truth accurately to others. And teachers, God's blessed some people to be teachers. The next gift on the list in Romans 12 is that of his exhortation. We looked at that this morning. I'm reading Romans 12:8, or he who exhorts in his exhortation. The New Living Translation says this: if your gift is to encourage others, be encouraging. I wanted to talk briefly about Bible translations, and I'll just cut off on the sidetrack for a minute. So what's the difference between a paraphrased Bible and a Bible translation, some people ask? A translation of the Bible is going from the original language of Hebrew, Aramaic, or Greek, translating to whatever language to the receiver, in our case, English, or to French, or whatever. But a Bible translation is going to go from word to word, from the original language to the language of the receiver, in our case, English. Some great Bible translations are out there. King James, the New King James, which is a great Bible translation, just takes out the these and the thous that I always stumble over. I have issues. The New American Standard is a great translation. NIV, New International Version. The English Standard Version, the ESV, is another great Bible translation. All excellent translations. You can't go wrong with any of those translations. So it's kind of what your preference is. But if you translate it, especially John 3:16, it can be the same in every single translation. But then there's paraphrased Bibles. And paraphrased Bibles, like the Amplified Bible or the Living Bible, and in a sense, the New Living Translation is kind of a blend between a translation and a paraphrase. A paraphrase means to re-speak something, to speak in a sense that makes it more easier to understand. So like the Amplified Bible, the Living Bible, is a paraphrase. It's going to take the context of the passage and rephrase it in a way that's easier to understand, more content. But it's not necessarily true to the words that's trying to explain something. Great resource to use, but if you're trying to do a word study with a paraphrased Bible, you're gonna be a lot of frustration because there's gonna be words in there that's not in the original language. Just understand the limitations of that. A paraphrased Bible, like an Amplified Bible, the Living Bible, is really good to help explain a passage. But if you want to do a little digging, what does this word mean in the original language? You want to stick with the other translations. Well, as long as I'm on the subject of translations, I want to talk about a Bible that's not even a translation. That is the Passion Translation, used by Bethel Church and the New Apostolic Reformation. It's not even a translation. It's a total misspeak. Brian Simmons, by his own admission, the guy who wrote it, rather than a team of scholars who did it, Brian Simmons says, God told him that God got the Bible wrong and he wanted Brian to rewrite the Bible. That's what he did. My friend, it's no different than Joseph Smith in the Book of Mormon. Same category. The Passion Translation is not even a translation. And it's rewritten in this man's thought, what he thinks God wants him to say. And so it's just total departure from the truth. I don't waste your money on it. Just saying. King James, NIV, New American Standard, ESV, a lot of great translations out there. Stick with a good, reliable translation of the Bible for you to use. But we're talking about exhortation. Sorry about that. I'm talking about the New Living Translation briefly. The spiritual gift of exhortation, along with prophecy and teaching, are considered one of the speaking gifts. And those with the spiritual gift of exhortation are being motivated to come alongside others to strengthen and encourage people in their walking with God. The word exhortation, to encourage, is the Greek word parakaleo, means to come alongside, to support, to strengthen, encourage. It's like a person who's struggling and they're off balance. You come alongside, grab by the arm and grab them and just kind of study them and help them along. And God has given people with the gift of exhortation or encouragement to the church. And they're cheerleaders. When you come across one, they're just so great to have around because they just uplift your soul. classic story of a person with the gift of encouragement or exhortation is that of Barnabas in the book of Acts. Let's look to Acts chapter 4 for a moment. Keep your Roman pencil and Romans 12, we'll be right back. But Acts chapter 4, we're introduced to Barnabas. And we're going to see Barnabas living out the gift of exhortation in his life. His name wasn't really Barnabas, that's what his nickname was. His actual name was Joseph. I'm reading Acts chapter 4, verses 36 to 37. And Acts 4, 36 says, "Now Joseph, a Levite of Cyprian birth, was also called Barnabas by the apostles, was translated means son of encouragement, and who owned a tract of land and sold it and brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet." And we're introduced to him as the son of encouragement. We're going to find later on he's going to be used by God to, in Saul's life. Saul, or would later be known as the Apostle Paul, was an enemy of the gospel, encountered Jesus Christ on the road to Damascus, and he was saved. But he had recently gone to Damascus to arrest and persecute Christians. And naturally, the church was saying, well, this guy was coming to kill us, and now he's one of us? And there's some skepticism there, and naturally so. But I'm reading Acts chapter 9, verse 26 and 27. It says, "When he came to Jerusalem," meaning Saul or Paul, "he was trying to associate with the disciples, but they were all afraid of him, not believing he was a disciple. But Barnabas," verse 27, "took hold of him and brought him to the apostles and described to them how he had seen the Lord on the road and that he had talked to him and how at Damascus he had spoken out boldly in the name of Jesus." Barnabas came alongside Paul. Saul was just kind of adrift. He was a brand new Christian, new to all this stuff, very knowledgeable, but he was a new Christian. And Barnabas came alongside and took him basically by the arm and walked him through, introduced him to the disciples, the apostles, and helped him to get growing. That's what the exhorters and encouragers do. They help people, come alongside to help people who are struggling, to strengthen their faith and help them in a walk with God. In Acts chapter 11, we're going to go there now. And I'm not going to take the time to read the passage. In Acts 11, verses 19 and 26, Barnabas is going to go down to check out a report that people become Christians in the town of Antioch in Syria. So Barnabas went down to check it out and said, my goodness, the people are Christians and this is awesome. But he needed help. So what does he do? He went back and hunted down Saul of Tarsus. Said, Saul, you got to come out. I need your help. So he came and brought Saul back to Antioch. And so they ministered there. Saul and Barnabas ministered there, helping the disciples get grounded in the faith. That's what Barnabas did. Barnabas says, every case he's that of an encourager. The characteristics of those who have the spiritual gift of encouragement or exhortation. They tend to be extroverts. They tend to like people, be around people, opposite of introverts. They like to come alongside, encourage people as they work through problems. They see trials and sufferings as opportunities for right responses, which lead to greater maturity in Christ. Exhorters are concerned that people follow through and apply what they've been taught or preached. They want to see people grow. And they can become frustrated when people don't get excited about what they're excited about or the growth that they're not following through and growing as they should. They're almost always upbeat and optimistic. Say almost. They're usually the type of people who see a glass have water half full rather than half empty. Opposite of the pessimist. You'll find exhorters serving as pastors, teachers, and encouraging others to walk with God. And then you'll know when you see them. In fact, I'm sure that in some point in your Christian life, you can think of a person who just came alongside you and just came alongside and just so encouraged you. I have the number of people God used in my life to encourage me along my path. And, you know, they'll come right to mind. They had a gift of encouragement. They came alongside to encourage you. Now, an exhorter's favorite Bible verses will include Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25. Let's look there in the book of Hebrews for a couple minutes. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25. It says, "Not forsaking our own assembling together, but as the habit of some, but encouraging," again that word parakaleo, "encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near." They really want to encourage people to stand firm for God and to grow in grace. Another favorite verse of an exhorter or encourager is that of Hebrews chapter 12, verses 12 to 13. It says, therefore, strengthen the hands that are weak and the knees that are feeble, and make straight paths for your feet, that the limb that is lame will not be put out of joint, but rather be healed. They want to see people grow in their faith. And also another favorite verse of the exhorter is found in Hebrews 3:13. It says, but encourage one another day after day, as long as still called today, so that none of you be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. Now, there can't come an abuse or neglect of the gift of exhortation. Those who have been given that spiritual gift, if not walking in spirit, they can come become discouraged when people are not excited or enthusiastic as they are about things of God. Exhorters are sometimes pushed too hard and provide too much counseling, too much, and too early, that it can be off-putting to some people who are new in the faith. Exhorters want to, and they often will seem to have answers, but they're not waiting for God's timing to share that information. Exhorters tend to be overly conscious of successes and failures in their attempts to exhort. And sometimes an exhorter's step of action or correction may be seen as simplification of the problem. And say, well, if you do this, this, and this, you're going to be great. But sometimes life is not that simple. Life gets complicated, can they not? And sometimes people's lives are very complicated, not so much in their lives, but because there's family members, and life gets complicated. Because people are very complicated, and sin can mess things up. Exhorters are given a special reminder, Romans 12:12. I'm looking back to Romans 12. That I rejoice in hope, persevering in tribulation, be devoted to prayer. Exhorters, if you have the gift of exhortation, you need to rejoice in hope. Even if you don't see much progress or apparent spiritual growth, don't give up. Just keep on moving forward and exhorting, encouraging people. Exhorters need to be patient with slow spiritual progress. Sometimes people say, why don't, if they would only do this. Have you ever said that? If only they would do this. Well, people don't. Sometimes they have to learn the hard way. And so exhorters need to be very patient, persevering in tribulation and in the trials, but also be devoted and diligent in prayer for themselves as well as for others. Those with the gift of exhortation are a blessing to the church. And again, I mentioned we can just think of the people God has used in our lives to bless us and come alongside us. And Frank, we need more Barnabases. And if you have the spiritual gift of exhortation, are you employing that gift? We need you. We need people to come alongside and encourage one another. So if that's the gift God has given you, put it to work for the furtherance of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm going to move on to the fifth motivation gift, that of giving. Romans chapter 12, verse 8 says, and he who gives with liberality or generosity, as some translations say. And again, the New Living Translation says, if your gift is giving, give generously. Those with the spiritual gift of giving are motivated to impart personal assets and possessions to those to meet needs and help spread the gospel message. And there's often a misunderstanding that those who have the gift of giving are wealthy. Not necessarily so. They may be, but not always. See, it's not the amount of the gift, but the motivation. The why and how they give to meet needs. And there's some patterns of what happens when people have a gift of giving. First off, why does the giver give? Givers are motivated to support a ministry or work that gives evidence of results. They want to invest in a ministry that's going to count for the kingdom and fulfill the Great Commission. And they want to be good stewards of what God has given to them and be assets and to accomplish that Great Commission. A person who has a gift of giving is going to take very seriously the words of our Lord Jesus Christ found in Matthew chapter 6. Look to Matthew 6 for a moment. And while, yes, all believers are to be givers, God's gift is some with a very special gift of giving. And they're just simply amazing thing to watch happening and as they do and see their gift in action. Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 and 21. They take this verse very seriously. It says, do not store for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, where thieves do not break in or steal, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. That's their motivation to give. They want to invest in the kingdom of God. and in heaven. How do they give? They often give secretly, anonymously, without fanfare. Matthew 6, 1 to 4, another favorite verse of those who have the gift of giving. Matthew 6, verses 1 to 4. Matthew 6 says in verse 1, "Beware of practicing your righteousness before men to be noticed by them. Otherwise you have no reward with your Father who is in heaven. But when you give to the poor, do not sound a trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and the streets, that they be honored by men. But I say to you, when they have the reward in full, but when you give to the poor, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving will be done in secret, and your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Givers do give to help individuals in need, but they're often seen as supporting on the ministries, but they're going to do it in the background. They don't want fanfare. As an example, Barnabas' motivation when he gave, we talk about him giving, selling a piece of tract of land and giving to the disciples, he did so publicly. He didn't do it to toot his horn, but he wanted to be an encouragement to others to do it as an example, to come alongside. In contrast, a giver is going to give quietly. They want to remain anonymous. They want to be in the background. And very, quite honestly, most major mission organizations and parachurch organizations such as Samaritan's Purse, the rescue missions, other outreach programs, including most missions, including village missions, have donors who give large amounts of money to help spread the gospel, but they don't want anyone to know about it. They do it quietly. Generally speaking, givers understand and apply God's principles of finances, and they find great joy in being God's instrument and blessing others. They understand God's four purposes of money. Remember, we covered that in our series on biblical finances. They understand that God uses money to provide for basic needs. They understand that God uses money to confirm His leading and direction for our lives and of His church. They understand that God uses others to meet others' needs through giving. And fourthly, they understand that God uses money to demonstrate His power and His greatness. Neglect or abuses of the gift of giving, if it's not Spirit-led or directed by the Holy Spirit. So those with the gift of giving may try to control what they give to rather than letting God lead. They try to be hands-on. They can become easily focused on temporal values. It can happen if not being walking in the Spirit. And they may use their giving an excuse to avoid their personal responsibility of engaging with people to encourage others and to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's why givers are given a special admonition in Romans chapter 12, verse 13. It says, contributing to the needs of the saints, practicing hospitality. Givers may step in to help, sometimes relieves a person's financial struggles when God's trying to get that person's attention. We talked about that before. So givers need to pray hard for discernment. Should I give? Should I not? What's God doing? And they want to be really wait upon the Lord. Givers can sometimes be stingy or frugal in their own giving, thus the exhortation to give generously. Often, misunderstanding of the gift of giving. Givers are often misunderstood. Those with the gift of giving may be misconstrued as trying to control direct ministry when they're just simply trying to help it be more effective and to accomplish, be good stewards of God's money. Since givers don't respond to every need request, they may be misunderstood as being uncaring or Scrooge-like or worldly. They're very prayerfully considering what God would have them to do with the resources that God would have them to give to. And if God's not motivating givers to give to a certain particular church or ministry, then that potential recipient needs to reevaluate itself before the Lord as its priorities, its motives, its methods, and its effectiveness in fulfilling the Great Commission. Because givers are not going to waste their money on something that's not living, doing right before the Lord. Because givers are sometimes frugal in their personal finances, in order to be able to give to the Lord's work, this may cause frictions in families. Givers need to be sure their family's needs are met. It means keeping up on home repairs or car repairs, roof leaks, etc. And some closing observations on the spiritual gift of giving. While all of us are called to give to the Lord in His work, God empowers some to be super givers. And those with the gift of giving are motivated to impart personal assets and possessions that God brings into their presence to meet needs and help spread the gospel message. And truly, the motivation gift of giving is perhaps one of the most spiritual of the gifts. Givers themselves marvel at experiencing firsthand the truth of 2 Corinthians chapter 9. We'll look there. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, Paul talked about giving. In the context, he's talking about they were taking a love offering. He's talking about the blessings of being a giver and of giving to the Lord and giving to meet needs of others. In 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8 through 10, the scripture says, "And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that always having all sufficiency in everything, you may have an abundance for every good deed. As is written, he scattered abroad, he gave to his poor, his righteousness endures forever. Now he supplies seed for the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for growing, sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness." Givers understand that, and they marvel themselves to see as they give of their assets, that they give it away to meet the needs and further the kingdom, just to turn and find that God has brought other sources of income to them. And to replace what they spend, they turn around and give it away. And God loves a hilarious giver, how that works. Those with the spiritual gift of giving are within almost every local church, but you'll never ever identify them or recognize them as they give their gift, exercise their gift quietly, not drawing attention to themselves. They don't want attention. And usually only those like the church treasurer, or those involved in church and finance in the county might have a clue, but they're going to keep their confidence also. Again, we confuse the gift of giving with having wealth. Not necessarily so. Givers may be poor by the world standards, but yet they're spiritually wealthy, knowing that their treasure is laid up for heaven, where thieves and moths and rust cannot steal, tarnish, or destroy. And they always have something to impart to others to meet needs and further the gospel message. Folks, we talked about two of the spiritual gifts. There's other ones we talked about and we'll talk about yet. All seven of these gifts are working together. Each are important and each have a role to play. And of all of us in this room, all seven gifts are represented. To the prophets, those with the gift of prophecy, prophecy emphasized the need for people to get right with God through salvation, encourage people to stay right with God by walking in holiness. Servers seek to meet those practical physical needs among God's people in the church. Teachers help ground God's people in the truth of God's word. Exhorters come alongside and strengthen or walk in practical ways and encourage people who are downtrodden and just say, you can do it, let's walk by faith and come alongside to encourage them, the being a Barnabas. Givers give to invest and further God's kingdom, plus meet the needs of other believers and bless God's people. Two more gifts we need to talk about. We'll talk about next time we're in spiritual gifts, those with the gift of administration, who provide coordination and structure for efficient and effective ministry to others. And they're so needed, and you see them, they come alongside, that person got the gift of administration because they're very organized. And then there's the last gift, that of the gift of mercy. Those who will comfort and encourage those who are downtrodden or hurting. A person with a gift of mercy, they'll be in a room, and say, that so-and-so is hurting, and you'll say, what's wrong with them? They can sense in a room that someone's heartbroken. Something's going on inside them. Without having to express it, they just have that supernatural ability to sense that. And we'll be talking about those next time we are in spiritual gifts. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the gifts that you've given to us. We just kind of did a sampler, just a quick overview, and try to describe what these gifts are like. And Father, these gifts are given by your Holy Spirit. And you've given us, Lord, these gifts within the local church. Not for our own personal edification, but for building up the body of Christ as we function together. And we'll see this as we continue on into the passage in 1 Corinthians 12 and 13 and 14 as we continue on. Father, we thank you for each of the gifts that you've given. A blessing to the church that would be a blessing to each other. Lord, we are not to function alone, but to be part of the body of Christ. And I thank you for those. And Lord, may we be diligent in exercising the gifts you've given to us within the body. With humility, focusing not on ourselves, but upon the needs of others around us. Lord, we give you praise, and we thank you for the blessing that you've given to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us stand and we'll close with a song.
One star burns in the darkness, shines with a promise, Emmanuel. One child born in the stillness, living within us, Emmanuel. We're singing glory, glory.
Let there be peace.